the program that fearlessly addresses any question, no matter how controversial, and tells you the things you need to know, even if you don't want to hear them. Case in point, the lack of respect. This is something that's bothered me for a long time. The lack of the proper respect received by Dolly Parton. Dolly Parton, I believe, is one of the great music talents of the last 75 years, and she doesn't get her due often enough, but she got her due recently from our next guest. Annie Zaleski is based in Cleveland, Ohio. She's a freelance writer, editor, journalist, marketing consultant, writes a lot on music for Salon, among other places, and she recently wrote a piece with the headline, "What Every Woman in Music Owes Dolly Parton." So first of all, Annie, thanks for coming on the program.
Right on. Thank you for having me.
Well, it was great to, I knew I had to talk about this. So now you and I, you know, our editors come up with the headlines and the subheadlines most of the time, but, you know, the subheadline here, "How Parton Influenced, Empowered, and Made Possible the Successes of Lady Gaga, Keisha, Miley Cyrus, and Many More." Overstating the case, or did she really do all that?
You know, I think she absolutely did that. You figure, you know, Parton has been recording for 50 years. It's almost easy to take her for granted because, you know, she just has always been there. And, you know, recently she's actually on Kesha's new record. She does a song that she actually, it was a number one single. Parton actually took it. I'm sorry. I'm totally like cut off. But yeah, no. So Parton actually in 1980 had a number one single with a song that Kesha's mom actually wrote. And so Kesha on her new record decided to re-record it and called up Dolly. And so Dolly is there too, and they duet, and they're amazing. You know, I mean, they both have really strong voices. And Dolly's actually Miley Cyrus's godmother, which I don't know how many people know, but Dolly's also on Miley's new record, which is coming out at the end of September. So she kind of is bridging these generations. You know, she kind of paved the way for these artists, but she's also getting honored by them as well.
Well, and the song you're talking about, is that "Old Flames Can't Hold a Candle to You"? Okay, now I'll reveal some biographical data. I remember when that song came out. In fact, I go so far back as a teenager, I was a country and western singer myself at a dude ranch in the Catskills. And Dolly Parton at that point was with Porter Wagoner. They were a duo. And in fact, I remember going to see them in Berkeley, California, and waiting online for an autograph, and the Grateful Dead were ahead of us online. But Dolly Parton had a song, I think it was 1966, called "Just Like a Woman," which are you familiar with that song?
I'm not, I'd have to look it up. I'm sure you said so many songs, I don't remember offhand.
Well, it was kind of a feminist breakthrough song, given that country music was not in a feminist environment at the time. The chorus was a cheating song, but the chorus was, "My mistakes are no worse than yours just because I'm a woman." And that was controversial stuff back in the day. Did Dolly Parton play a role, you think, in like that throughout the years, more than once, of kind of pushing the envelope for what was considered acceptable gender politics, if you will?
You know, I think so, because you mentioned Porter Wagoner. I mean, so she, you know, obviously got her start on the TV show with him. But after a while, she kind of decided, you know what, I need to go out on my own. I want to step out on, you know, she'd done some solo work. She's like, I want to, you know, strike it out and see, land on my own two feet and do this. So she sat down and she didn't know how to tell him. And so she wrote a song, "I Will Always Love You," that basically set everything she needed to say. And, you know, I mean, I think everyone knows that song at this point, because not just her, but then Whitney Houston and Beyonce has covered that. And that was kind of her statement. Like, this is, you know, I, you know, will care for you. This, I really appreciate what you did for me, but I need to strike out on my own. And so I think that was kind of the first stab of her, you know, basically kind of having this kind of feminine and female empowerment path. I mean, you think of 9 to 5 as well, which is, I think, one of her other famous crossover singles, which was from a movie where she was starred in the movie. And it was the same thing. It was, you know, I have to deal with this jerk boss. He's, you know, a total misogynist. He's kind of an asshole. But, you know, I have my coworkers, and I'm not going to let it get me down. So she's had that stuff over the years, and it's been a little bit more subtle, I think, you know, just from a songwriting standpoint. But just the way she's kind of also kind of approached her career. She's worked with so many women. And I think if you kind of, I started doing some research, and I mean, she's, you look at country music legends, she's worked with everybody. You know, she's worked with Loretta Lynn, who also knows a little something about, you know, kind of feminine empowerment and female empowerment. You know, she's worked with Emmylou Harris as well. And, you know, she really, she's never been afraid to work with women, and she's always kind of lifted them up as well. And that's always really impressed me, because, you know, that's you don't always see that. You know, women always often feel threatened by other women, but she's always really had respect for them. And, you know, kind of by her, the word I'm looking for, by her, totally blanking on the word, basically by her example, I guess, leading by example, she's really kind of been an empowering figure.
Well, and by her sort of command of her career, she has Dollywood. She's, you know, obviously very sharp, which is her theme park in Tennessee. She obviously is very sharp on the business side of things as well. And by the way, your pitch about 9 to 5, have you thought of giving that pitch to the Democratic Socialists of America? Maybe they'll maybe they'll adopt it as a theme song. She also wrote a song that Emmylou Harris did called To Daddy, if you know that song, about the mother of the singer of the song leaves her husband looking for fulfillment in life, which I thought was pretty radical for the 70s or 80s as well. So what should people, most people, if they know who she is, but she's kind of this, I would say, caricature figure of, you know, with the wigs and the, you know, and the big boobs and the flashy clothes and I think she said once in Rolling Stone that most women have as much jewelry and wigs as she does, but they don't wear them all at once. You know, she's kind of comedian. What should people know that they don't know about her?
I mean, I think also that, you know, I think I touched on this a little bit, but she is a fantastic songwriter. I mean, she, you know, she obviously has worked with some of the greats through the years, but she also writes her own stuff. You know, she has a children's record coming out in September and October, and she wrote all the songs for it, you know. And I think people might not necessarily, you know, you look at someone like Dolly Parton, and if you didn't know any better, you might say, oh, she's just interpreting other people's words, or she's, you know, taking what other people have done and kind of capitalizing on it. She's just entertainment. But she's behind so much of her catalog and so much of her music. And I think that's important as well, because, you know, you don't, you know, when you look at country music, you know, all of the male songwriters and the male stars, but you think about, she is just, you know, amassed this body of work, not just as a singer, but then also kind of as a songwriter as well. And the fact, I think, that her charity work, you know, she has just been amazing in terms of, she has a library where she gives a kid a free book every month. And she's given over, I can't remember the exact tally, I think she's up to 100 million books, or I'd have to look it up, but it was incredible.
Yeah, and I think on the songwriter front, by the way, you know, I actually think that if she were a man, she would be recognized on the level of Hank Williams, Merle Haggard, some of the great singer-songwriters, other great singer-songwriters. I think her body of songwriting stands up with the best of them. And my sense is that because she's a woman and she's used, you know, a persona to get where she is, that she's not given enough credit for the greatness. I mean, I could rattle off 15 Dolly Parton songs that I think are complete classics.
You know, and we're seeing this a little bit right now with Taylor Swift and her new single, which I think has just been dominating the internet for the last, gosh, week or so, that, you know, you forget that Taylor wrote a ton of her music, writes a ton of her music, and came off and she's, you know, kind of reinvented herself. And people have just kind of turned on her because she's embracing a different sound and a pop edge. And I think Dolly had that a little bit as well, too, because, you know, she's really gone through different styles over the years. And I think as I was kind of doing some research and looking over it, she has touched on everything. You know, she's touched on disco, she's touched on pop, she's touched on bluegrass, country, folk. I mean, she's really, her body of work is also very diverse. You know, and not everyone can handle kind of that, you know, that veering back and forth and that kind of chameleonic approach to their career as well. You know, but she's not, she's, you know, very much associated with country music, but she's not necessarily kind of beholden to any sort of stereotypes or boundaries or anything that the genre kind of implies.
Yeah, she sang a song by Barry Gibb of the Bee Gees, too, so she could pretty much. Okay, you wrote this piece. Have you gotten, and again, we're talking with Annie Zaleski about her piece on what every woman in music owes Dolly Parton. And by the way, she's also been a great voice for the LGBTQ community as well, who's a big portion of her fan base, and she's been really embracing of them, which is, when she began doing it, was not at all typical of country and Western singers. And you mentioned that in your movie. What's the response been to your piece?
You know, I haven't actually heard. I'm surprised. I think just because of it came out right when Taylor Swift was sort of dominating the internet and still is, I haven't heard much about it. And I'm actually really surprised by that because, you know, I think Dolly is such a, you know, you mention her and she's such a lightning rod for just being beloved. You know, I mean, people, whenever you tweet about her, whenever I talk about her, you know, she is just, you know, people are like, she's an angel. You know, she's just, she's a treasure. You know, we don't deserve Dolly Parton. And so I'm going to kind of seed it around now that the Taylor, you know, kind of, I don't know, furor has decreased a little bit, and to see what kind of response I get. Because, yeah, you know, and I think last year, because Dolly went on a huge tour last year, and I think had this come out like last year, because she was really in the public eye and doing a lot of things, it probably would have gotten a little more attention offhand.
Well, it certainly got attention from us, and I'm trying to think as we go forward here, if you had to put together a Dolly Parton playlist, I'm really going to put you on the spot now. And by the way, I have to mention, I appreciate everything Taylor Swift has accomplished, but she had wealthy, supportive parents. You know, dad worked for Goldman Sachs. Dolly Parton came from nothing, from poverty, extreme rural poverty, to do everything she's done, and I think she deserves huge credit for this. If you had to put together a 8-song Dolly Parton playlist for newcomers, what would it be?
Oh, man. All right. So let me start. I mean, I think you have to do, just for sentimental reasons, Islands in the Stream. Because, you know, we didn't really talk on that, but that's really become kind of a pop culture touchstone even, you know, with her and Kenny Rogers. I think people have parodied that, people have covered that. So I think that, you know, 9 to 5, I mean, you have to. Jolene, I think, is a must. I Will Always Love You. You know, anything from the Trio record, I think, just because, you know, I love Emmylou Harris. And so, like, I can't, you know, and Linda Ronstadt. So, I mean, you can't get enough of that. Trying to see here, how many is that?
You know, that's like, close,
you know,
enough.
An early song like Dumb Blonde. We didn't talk on Dumb, that, but you know, reading about kind of when she performed that live and how she really kind of turned the tables on people.
This Dumb Blonde is nobody's
kind of,
fool.
You know, knowing wink that right. Here, you know, here's what I am, but you know, you don't underestimate me. So I think about that as well.
Yeah.
And you know, I honestly love Baby I'm Burning. I know that it's like it's associated with the disco era, but I found a really awesome, like a pink 12-inch last year, and I had to buy it.
All
it's
right.
So cool. Well, you know, she owned it, and it's a great song, though.
No, she has a lot of grace, and I would add to that, you know, just because I'm a woman, and yeah, This Dumb Blonde is nobody's fool. I remember that. So, okay, we'll get there. I think we've got a pretty good playlist now. So, unfortunately, we're going to have to leave it there, but Annie Zaleski, freelance writer, fellow admirer of Dolly Parton, thanks for writing this piece, and thanks for coming on the program.
Right on. Thanks for having me.